First up, a rundown of some of our recent headlines. The U.S. Supreme Court issued a flurry of rulings recently, including legalization of gay marriage in all 50 states. And while some governors have been slow to implement the court's ruling, same-sex marriage is now the law of the land. Later on the show, we'll take you down to the celebration outside of the Supreme Court building. The High Court also upheld Obamacare. In other news, Maryland Governor Larry Hogan has begun chemotherapy. This comes after the newly elected governor disclosed that he has non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. In the district, halfway through 2015, and the homicide rate in the nation's capital is up by 20% compared to last year. So far, 68 murders. This is the third year in a row that the homicide rate will go up after several years of decline. And yes, Virginia, the ground did shake. The U.S. Geological Survey confirms two minor earthquakes earlier this week. And now, my conversation with D.C. Councilmember Kenyan McDuffie. Councilmember, welcome back to NewsPlus.
Thanks for having me, Mark.
There's a lot to talk about. I think the first thing we want to get into is a case that has really just gripped the nation, really. It's national news, is this quadruple murder investigation in Ward 3. This is a family of three and their housekeeper who were just brutally beaten to death, set on fire, house was broken into, and apparently for a $40,000 ransom. One person is in custody so far. He's been charged with capital murder, but the police chief has already said that they believe that there are others involved who they're still trying to track down. First, you sit on the Judiciary Committee. You've been a prosecutor. I've been a reporter for a lot of years. Really, the most horrific crime I think I've ever covered.
I agree. I mean, this is one of the most heinous crimes that I've seen in my lifetime. You know, it is so tragic. You think about the family. You think about the little girls who are left to grow up without parents. And it's just absolutely horrific. And we've already got one arrest. And I think that anybody else who had anything to do, absolutely anything to do with this crime, needs to be arrested, tried, and brought to justice.
And so that brings me to a question that a lot of people are talking about, is about the death penalty, whether this rises to level. And we, you know, the District of Columbia does not have the death penalty, but you know, we don't. Everybody knows. I don't have to tell you, D.C. is in a bit of an odd space because our cases are tried by federal prosecutors. So, is there an opportunity here for the death penalty? You've been a prosecutor. You're a lawyer. Understand this realm.
Yeah, I've been a prosecutor. I am not Vincent Cohen, who's the acting U.S. attorney here in the District of Columbia. There is a federal death penalty, but as you mentioned, Mark, there is not a local death penalty. And just personally, I oppose the death penalty. But I will say that, again, I think it bears repeating, anybody who has anything to do with this crime needs to be tried and brought to justice. And if they're convicted, they need to spend the rest of their lives in prison.
Let's stay a little bit in that public safety realm. Body cameras, this is something that you know a lot about, police body cameras. We've seen all over the country the pressure for more police body cameras after things like we see in Baltimore and around the country with police interacting with citizens, sometimes not in the best way.
Sure.
The district, the chief, the mayor wanted to put body cameras on every single police officer. I think it's about 4,800 sworn. She already has a pilot program with several dozen or more cameras on officers.
Sure.
The budget called for funding, for fully funding this. You, through your committee, you kind of put the brakes on a little bit. She ended up not getting the full funding for all of the cameras she wanted, just about half the cameras. Tell us exactly where we are and why you did what you did in the council there.
Sure. Well, as a chair of the Committee on the Judiciary, Mark, as you know, we received from the mayor a budget proposal that would have funded, to the tune of $5.1 million, 2,400 cameras. And we had a number of hearings. We had a roundtable on body-worn cameras here in the District of Columbia. And what we found out was that although we did have a pilot program that started last April, there wasn't a lot of data collected during the pilot program that was shared with us. So we didn't really have details as to how the program worked. We didn't have details with respect to whether we saw a decrease in use of force or whether we saw a decrease in the amount of complaints that were filed against officers. And so I thought we should take a more measured approach. And all of my colleagues in the council agreed with me. And so we scaled back the funding. And we're going to fund, when it's all said and done, next fiscal year, the MPD will have a total of 1,600 cameras. Still one of the most robust body-worn camera programs in the country. We think that the chief and the officers there should have body-worn cameras. I believe that body-worn cameras can help. We want to make sure that we are collecting data and that they're working with researchers to determine how and if things are working and if there's anything that we need to do better. And one of the most critical issues, Mark, was that the mayor's budget language would have created a blanket exemption against the Freedom of Information Act that we have here in
District of Columbia. And this is kind of the second prong of this issue, was not just the data and the implementation that you're talking about, but the access that the public, and I say as a reporter, I was the first, the chief is quick to point this out, I was the first reporter to put in a Freedom of Information request asking to see some of that camera footage, and we've been denied. The chief of police does not want to release any of that camera footage really to anyone except prosecutors and defense attorneys.
Sure. So all of the requests that have been submitted to MPD have been denied thus far. And the issue that I have is that there's not been the case made that we need to have a blanket FOIA exemption. Conversely, we've seen other jurisdictions around the country that have worked with the public. They've worked with journalists to allow access. And we want to make sure that we take a measured, reasonable approach to this. So the BSA, the budget language that we passed in my committee and was supported on the first vote by the council, would establish an advisory group that would work with MPD, and it would include organizations like the ACLU, DC Open Government, and others who have experience with this, who are going to raise those very important questions to see whether and if we can have the type of access that allow the public to know what's going on. And actually, just last Friday, the first meeting was held of the advisory group, and I am really optimistic about what the outcome is going to be and the rules that MPD is ultimately going to draft for approval by the council.
But we are going to start seeing more cops with more cameras on.
Yeah, we're going to see more cops with more cameras. As a matter of fact, we're going to see them sooner rather than later. The MPD is already prepared to roll out a camera program in 5th District and 7th District. And we're going to have more details of that, which is going to be forthcoming. But I think we're on to something here in the District of Columbia. We just need to be careful about how we approach this. And we need to make sure that to the extent we can, that we protect privacy, but we also allow access to the extent it does not violate anyone's personal privacy. We already have FOIA exemptions that are already on book, as you know, Mark. And I think that if there's a reason to deny it based on an ongoing investigation, the law already allows for that. If there's a reason to deny a FOIA request for body-worn camera footage because of someone's privacy, the law already allows for that as well.
Let me ask you another topic, and that is the minimum wage. We saw what happened in California. The district just passed some legislation recently which gradually increases the minimum wage ahead of the federal minimum wage, but California just passed $15 an hour. Would you entertain a $15 an hour minimum wage?
I'd like to see our minimum wage get up to $15 an hour. Having grown up here in the District of Columbia, knowing how expensive it is to live, to have a decent quality of life, I'd like to see it get up to $15, but I also support the action that the council took last year when we passed a new minimum wage, and we just next month in July we're going to have a minimum wage that goes up to $9.50. The next year is going to go up to $10.50. In 2017 it's going to go up to $11.50, and thereafter it's going to be tied to our consumer price index.
So you're okay to get to 15, you don't want to just get there overnight?
I think we were deliberative and put a lot of thought into what we passed recently, and I'd like to see it play out. Ultimately though, we want to make sure that we people who work here in the District of Columbia can afford to live here, that they can take care of themselves and they can take care of their families. And you know, if it means $15 a month and there's a way to get us to that point, then I'm open to exploring that. For the time being, though, I think that we took a very reasonable approach to raising the minimum wage, and we had support and we've seen similar actions from some of our colleagues in Maryland as well.
Kenyan McDuffie represents Ward 5 on the District Council. Councilmember, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Mark.
We'll be right back. Stay right there. When NewsPlus returns, we'll tell you all about the Quitter's Circle.